Wow. Fast cars plus some big explosions. Well, that equals box office gold for Fast and Furious 7. $143 million on opening weekend, to be exact. And just for a little perspective there, that's almost twice as much as 50 Shades of Grey. The seventh film in the Fast and Furious franchise is the last movie that was made by actor Paul Walker before his death in a car crash in 2013. And his inclusion in this film, no doubt a big draw for audiences of the franchise. But it was the stunts that really have a whole lot of people talking. And joining me to talk about these things now from a movie set is the man responsible for setting up those really incredible scenes. We have stunt coordinator Jack Gill. So, Jack, thanks for being with us. And just give us a sense. This is one of the, you call it Fast, as the franchise, you call it Fast. One of the things that I know you said Fast prides itself on is that so much of this is real. So how much is real? How much is computer generated?
Well, I mean, we started on Fast 5, and back then we said we want to get the audiences back in the seats. And the only way to do that is to have them be a part of the action. So you had to go back to doing things real. So the mantra at Universal Studios has been, we want you to guys to do everything as real as possible. So throughout Fast 5 and Fast 6 and now Furious 7, we've all gone back to doing real stunts. And so everything that you see in 7 is real as much as we can make it. So that's the thing that we're really proud of.
And one of the scenes in particular that I think a lot of folks may have seen in the preview, this involves a transport plane and some very expensive cars. Let's take a look at that.
Just when you didn't think it could get any better, huh?
Okay, this is real, by and large. I'm assuming you mean the actors in the plane, in the cars, not. But throwing planes out of the back of a transport plane, this is real. Explain to us how on earth you guys did this.
Well, I mean, we did it with a lot of rehearsal, and that was the one thing that was the key to the success, is that we started with just one car, and we found out that they all flip upside down and turn all in different directions. And we liked that in some of the shots, but you can't have all six cars doing that at once. So, you know, there were a lot of different ways to make cars fall the way that you wanted to make them fall. And then you've got to take into consideration, how do you film it? So now we've got a bunch of camera operators that are skydivers out there with the cars falling, and they all fall at different rates of speed. But we overcame all of those boundaries and finally got everybody out together. And it was a fantastic, you know, sequence for us.
Yeah, it's an amazing scene. It is just, your heart just kind of thumps watching it. I want to talk to you about a serious note about this film, which obviously so many people are familiar with, and that is Paul Walker's death in the middle of filming. This was a really tough one for producers and for people like yourself who worked with him, who are associated with the film. In the end, they decided to use CGI and previous footage of Walker to lay over his performances by his twin brothers. What can you tell us about how that was emotionally and logistically?
Well, I mean, it was a complete shock to all of us, because when we first heard about it, we thought it was just another thing on the internet that you hear and it can't be true. And it took 10 to 15 calls before we finally found out that, you know, this really did happen. And it was a shock to the crew. We couldn't even talk about it on the set for days on end, until we finally all got together and everybody just kind of sat together and talked about Paul. And the tough part about it was that we knew that Paul would want us to finish this thing out and to try and get as much out of this as we could, because he really worked hard on every single picture. He gave it his everything that he had, 100% on every single shot. And he was always the nicest guy around. He didn't have any attitude. There was no problem with, you know, if you wanted him to stay later, if you wanted him to work harder on something, if you needed more things out of him, he would give you everything that he had. So we figured to finish this on his behalf, we wanted to do it the very best that we could. So the crew actually came together and really, you know, compounded everything that we did to make it better for all of us.
and it's great, and I'm sure he would have loved it as well. It must have been a very difficult time for you. But thanks so much for talking to us about this and about the movie, Jack Gill. Really appreciate it. That does it for me. The Lead with Jake Tapper starts right now.